Stories about our origins shape us. On Friday, Jim and Mickey Moore and I had the privilege of visiting with Virginia Baxter, who is with us this morning. So good to see you. She's a long-term member of Good Sam. And this was my first time meeting her, so Virginia blessed us with many, many stories. And one of the stories she told us was about growing up in the Depression in an environment of scarcity and conservation, and how they were told you have to eat everything on your plate without complaining. She told us this story in the context of telling us about now eating in the dining hall at the assisted living facility, and how she tries to eat whatever they serve her with as much gratitude as she can muster and without complaint. Now, Virginia, though your children did not grow up in the Depression era, I imagine that they grew up hearing those stories from you. I imagine they heard about how they came from a people of resourcefulness and perseverance who went through tough times with gratitude and not complaint. Stories about our origins shape us. I recently read an article in the Tampa Bay Times. Jeff Klinkenberg, who's a staff writer there, wrote a piece about his own growing up. The story is entitled, "My Dad Had an Artist's Soul, but a Temper That Left Many Scars." The title sort of speaks for itself. The article juxtaposes these sweet, tender moments of a loving father teaching his son about life with harsh, cold moments of abuse. It captures the nuances and the gray that are present in many of our stories. This man's story is raw, and it's deep, it's slow to judge, and it's very eager to find some sort of redemption. Stories about our origins shape us. In ancient Babylon, they told a story about the Canaanites, the descendants of Ham. Now Ham, as you may remember, was Noah's son. And one day he happened to stumble upon Noah when Noah was passed out drunk and in the nude. Now we don't know whether his crime was seeing his father's nakedness. That was certainly a much more serious violation in ancient Babylon than today. Or whether seeing his father's nakedness is a euphemism for some more serious violation. But what we do know is that either way, Noah curses his son Ham and his descendants to be in servitude to their neighboring peoples, the children of Ham's brothers. Now some believe that this story developed as a way to justify the enslavement and the servitude of the Canaanites to these neighboring peoples. Later, through folk tales and traditions that developed, Ham and the Canaanites became associated with dark skin. These folk tales claimed that they were marked for the darkness of Ham's sin. Now, where exactly that tradition developed, it's nowhere mentioned in the biblical story. Where it came from, we don't know. But what we do know is that in 18th and 19th century Europe and America, when the slave trade from Africa was thriving and also starting to be questioned, this story about the curse of Ham became very popular. It was used to justify why people of dark-colored skin should be in servitude and people of lighter skin. Stories about our origins shape us. Biblical scholars have spent many, many years studying and looking for clues as to when the Genesis story first emerges among the Hebrew people. And the majority view is that the story began to be told when the Hebrew people were in captivity in Babylon, the Babylonian exile. As Barbara Brown Taylor describes in her book, A Luminous Light, In the creation story of that foreign culture, the cosmos was made from the dismembered corpse of the goddess Tiamat, whose skull was split by her youngest son, Marduk. By murdering his evil mother, Marduk brought order out of chaos with a redemptive act of violence. Now this was not, says Taylor, the story the Hebrew parents wanted their children to hear in the Babylonian schools. So she suggests they set their own story down, their own account about a good creation and a good God. A college professor of mine once told us that the book of Genesis was not primarily concerned with the how of creation or with scientific accuracy, that primarily it was concerned with the who of creation, with relationships. Of course, that made a lot of sense to me then, but I didn't fully develop a deep understanding of it until I heard about what Barbara Brown Taylor describes in her book, until I thought about those children in those Babylonian schools. It mattered to those Hebrew parents that their children heard about Earth as a gift entrusted to them, and not about Earth as a dismembered corpse. It mattered that their children knew that rest and peace and contentment were a part of the creation story, and not just violence. It mattered that their children learned that they came not from some dysfunctional family of semi-powerful gods, but that they came from an all-powerful God who could simply will something into existence. It mattered that their children knew they were created out of goodness and love, and not out of discord and strife. It mattered that their children knew they were created in the image of God, that there was something in them that reflected the goodness of God. It mattered because they knew our stories about our origins shape us. Since those Hebrew parents first began to tell their children this wonderful story about the origins of the cosmos, Christians have added a few things to our understanding of that story. The Gospel of John weaves into that creation story another character, a character that's there but not necessarily highlighted, the Word of God. The Word who will be made flesh in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. The Word through whom all of creation comes into being and without whom nothing comes into being. The Pentecost people that we heard about last week read that creation narrative through the lens of their experience with that Spirit, with that blowing wind and fire and that great presence that enlivened the waters of baptism, the waters of life. They read that Genesis story and they heard and saw the Spirit in it. The Spirit hovering over the waters, that invisible wonder worker that was bringing the Word of God to life. They also heard in the rich Hebrew language how God is described as us and we. Do you ever notice that when you read the Genesis story? And they found in that Genesis story a richness of understanding ourselves as a people created by and in the image of a God who is within God's self-community, loving, wonderful, creative community. More recently, some Christian traditions and even some Jewish traditions have looked back at the Genesis story and they've reclaimed that description of creation, that we are made in the image of God, male and female, equally made in the image of God. Despite years of patriarchy that has been bolstered by the church, they reclaimed that that ancient story of our origins about a God who is both male and female. A God who created all genders and calls us all good. These progressive readers of the creation narrative are considered by some to be rebellious voices. But they push hard for this new interpretation of the Genesis story because they know stories about our origins shape us. When those early Christians began to see the creating God as both unity and Trinity, it was not without controversy. More people lost their lives in debates about the Trinity than in the entire Spanish Inquisition. And though it's terribly sad that so many lost their lives over a theological debate, it reveals the gravitas of those discussions. Determining what the nature is of the source of all life, the one whose image we bear, it mattered. It mattered because they knew stories about our origins matter, and they shame us. When the Hebrew people told their children a countercultural creation story with the refrain, "It is good," it was a protest made out of love. Love for their children and for their future. When Martin Luther King Jr. challenged the myths about people of dark skin, myths that had continued even into his day, he did that as a protest of love for his children and all children and their future. When Virginia sits and eats her dinner with gratitude, remembering her beginnings when food was just, it was just good to have food at all. When she does that, it's a protest of something that is pervasive in the nursing home. A perspective that life can't be good now. Virginia claims life is good. When John Klinkenberg, that Tampa Bay staff writer, tells a story naming the violence and offering forgiveness and seeing both the nuances of good and bad in his own story, he does so in protest. Protest of the violence, but also protest of those who would label his childhood experience bad and fail to see the good in even his painful story. Stories about origins shape us. But we are not their victim. Like those Hebrew parents, like Dr. King, like Virginia, like John Klinkenberg, we claim our own story of who God created us to be. We claim our own story of our relationship with our Creator, our relationship with the rest of the earth. We choose to echo the refrain, "Is good. I am good. You are good. Creation is good. God is good." We choose to echo that refrain everywhere we go. Even in places where saying such things is a protest, we continue to claim that goodness. It can be a protest, but it is a protest made out of love. Love for our children, for the creatures of the earth, for all the living things, for our future that is still yet unknown. We make that protest because we, like the God who created us, are in community. We too live interconnected lives. And the stories we tell one another matter. Shape us. Just as the Creator, the Word, and the Spirit looked at creation and said to one another, "It is good," we 2. Let's look at one another and say it is good. We too must let that story resound.